So this is lesson number 13, final lesson of John MacArthur's Fundamentals of the Faith. This is on the subject of God's will and guidance. The memory verse was Ephesians 5:17, which says, "So then do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is." So this section starts out with this statement: God is sovereign and has a purpose for all of his creation. He has a plan or will for each of us, though we often make his will more difficult to respond to than it really is. In this lesson, we will explore God's will and how we are guided into it. So I think this is one of the most common questions, at least it used to be, when I would hear pastors talk about Q&As and the call-in shows where people would have their questions about God and Jesus and the Bible. And this was the most common question being asked: what is God's will for my life? And can you know God's will for your life? God doesn't give you specifics, obviously, in the Bible. He doesn't give specifics about what career field you should go into or what city to move to, what college to go to. He may lead you in other ways, which is part of this. But as far as the Bible, what is God's will in Scripture? If somebody asked you and they said, "Well, how do I know God's will for my life?" What would you say? What's some basic advice?
Pray on it.
Pray on it? Okay, we would probably say, you know, read the Bible and pray about it. Get into the Word and pray about it, because there are many things that are revealed. God's will for our life is our sanctification. That's one of the main things said in the New Testament. But here it says the Bible portrays two aspects of God's will: his sovereign will and his commanded will. In God's sovereignty, he has a plan that covers all aspects of creation and time. He also has a commanded will that he legislates to his people. Okay, so the sovereign will of God, in other words, can be a mystery. And then his revealed will are the commandments, for example, the commandments given in Scripture. So is it God's will? Here's something real basic. Is it God's will for you to lie and to steal? No. Well, see, you know that. But some of these other things can get a little more complicated. Now, have you ever heard this described in a different way? Because John MacArthur's breaking it down, and I've heard different ways of describing it, but basically two aspects of God's will: sovereign and commanded will. Has anyone heard anything different? I'm used to the... Go ahead.
His permissive will and right. His perfect will.
Yeah, that's how I've often heard it described. Permissive will, decretive will, permissive, and what was the other one? Permissive.
Permissive and perfect.
Yeah, his perfect will. Okay, so this, I think, is a little more simple. So we're going to have some verses to test out. It's okay. Bless you. We'll have some verses. We'll read and we'll say, okay, is this the sovereign will of God or the commanded will of God? That's on the next page. But just as a way of explaining this further, A, the meaning of God's will. Number one, God's sovereign will. God's sovereign will involves his ultimate, complete control over everything. And of course, there are some professing Christians, legitimate Christians, who don't actually believe that God is really controlling everything. There's, you know, the debate of the sovereignty of God and the free will of man and all that, which we don't need to get into this morning. But suffice to say that there would be people who see this a little differently, I think. But here it says God's sovereign will involves his ultimate, complete control over everything. Nothing happens that is not in God's plan. History is really the unfolding of God's purposes, which happen exactly as he planned. Okay, any comments or questions on that? Okay, at the very least, I think all Christians would agree that God knows what's going to happen before it happens, right? And God, in theory, he could change it so that it happened differently if he wanted to, right? I think all Christians would agree with that. So whatever happens, ultimately, at the very least, God either wills it or at the very least, he allows it and he works that out according to his purposes. You take the example of Joseph being sold into slavery. Obviously, that is not God's will. He did not want the brothers to despise Joseph and sell him into slavery. It's not the will of God to do evil. But in another way of looking at it, God used all of that to bring his will about, to save many lives in Egypt. So there's kind of two ways to look at it. So look up each of the following verses and write out the key thought about God's sovereign will. And the two verses were Isaiah 14, verse 24, and then Ephesians 1:11b. And you remember what the B, A and B, stand for. A is the beginning of the verse, and B is the second half of the verse. Okay, so Isaiah 14, verse 24 says, "Surely, just as I have intended, so it has happened. And just as I have planned, so it will stand." And who's speaking there?
God.
Okay, so that's a pretty clear statement that whatever happens, God is saying, I'm in control of it. All right, and then Ephesians 1:11b says, "Who works all things after the counsel of his will." So at least in one sense, anything that happens, it is the will of God. But then in another sense, if somebody does something like Joseph's brother, selling him into slavery, that was not God's commanded will. That's not what God wanted them to do. It was the wrong thing to do, but God allowed it to happen, willed it to happen, you could say, to bring about his purpose. Works all things after the counsel of his will. So we understand that. Any questions on that? Challenges to it? Because I can just imagine, yeah, there would be some churches, some church traditions that would really bristle at this idea of the sovereignty of God. Because they think that it makes God the author of evil. If something bad happens and you say that was God's will, in their mind, that's saying that God's will is that evil be done. That's not what's being said, obviously. Okay, Isaiah 46, 9 and 10. "I am God, and there is no one like me. My purpose will be established, and I will accomplish all my good pleasure." I forget if it's mentioned here or not, but in the book of Acts, it talks about how the crucifixion of Jesus was predestined or foreordained. So we would all agree that the crucifixion of the Son of God is the most evil thing ever done by the hands of men. And yet, it says it was foreordained. You know, he's the Lamb of God, foreordained from the foundation of the world. So this is a deep, deep subject. Number two, it says God's commanded will. God's commanded will is revealed through the Bible as laws or principles. It is that aspect of his will to which men are held accountable. Okay, so we looked at God's sovereign will. Now this is his commanded will. A, according to the Great Commission, Matthew 28, verse 20, what are new believers to be taught? What are new believers, and really all believers, to be taught? But this is the Great Commission. We make disciples, okay? We get people converted to Christ. We baptize them. The next step is to teach them all that Christ commanded. So a new believer should be taught what? Just the basics. Don't confuse them about the hard stuff. Well, you start out with the basics, but believers are to be taught all that Christ commanded. So that's the will of God, right? Is it the will of God that Christians be taught the whole counsel of God, the whole Bible? That's going to be partly what the sermon's about later, how Jesus, in the Sermon on the Mount, he said, "I did not come to destroy the law or the prophets, but to fulfill." So a lot of Christians have the idea that the Old Testament is kind of, you know, and there is a sense where the Old Covenant is obsolete. Hebrews says that. But in their mind, a lot of Christians think that the Old Testament is almost like irrelevant, that Jesus came to do away with that. Or if you try to quote a verse in the Old Testament as being authoritative, they're like, well, that doesn't count. That's the Old Testament. Well, not exactly. So we should teach the whole Bible. And when Jesus made that statement, of course, the only Bible there was the Old Testament. But yes, Larry.
Well, Paul wrote in 2 Timothy that all scripture is profitable. And then for doctrine, for teaching, for instruction, and all these things. And all scripture at the time was, what did Paul have? He had the Old Testament. He had the law. He didn't have in Peter's writings and Luke's writings. And,
yeah, right.
You know, he had the Old Testament.
Right.
He had the prophets.
Yep. So the Old Testament is the Bible too. Okay, B, God gave two great commandments. List them below. Matthew 22, verse 37, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And then Matthew 22, verse 39, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Okay, so that is part of God's commanded will. So we know that part of God's will, but there's a lot of things that are going to happen and why they happen that we don't really know God's will. Okay, so this is B, the nature of God's will. Go ahead.
Go back
sure.
to that, you know, the two great commandments. You know, I mean, how I have a hard time with loving God. How do I do it? I mean, that's, you know, I'm not obedient all the time, and I struggle with that, you know, and to keep his commandments and obey and do them, I'm not saying that I just break them all the time.
Yep.
It's something that to show my love for God, I need to be obedient.
Right.
And that's something hard, you know, how do I do it always?
And, yeah.
You know, it's something, it's difficult.
Right. Well, and I think that the way it's described in Scripture is helpful, where God is our Heavenly Father and we are His children. And of course, God is a good Father. He's perfectly just and His love for us is perfect. But we know how it is that children don't always obey their parents, right? But a child who really loves their parents will want to obey, but they don't always do it. They don't do it perfectly, certainly. But that's sort of the analogy, that we show our love for God, not because we have this feeling within ourselves. A lot of churches these days, the ministry, the methods, it's very emotion-based, and the commandments are kind of left off to the side. But really, in Scripture, we show our love for God by obeying God. And we obviously, that comes from the heart, if we're sincere. Marcus.
Well, as I was thinking about these two and the difference, and I did struggle with some of these to see which they fit into, but one thing became very clear to me, and that is that God's commanded will is something that I continually fall short. And it's a great goal. It is my goal. But of course, I live a lot more within His sovereign will. And Romans 8's been particularly helpful to me in some very personal situations that I'm going through. And of course, the most famous one perhaps is Romans 8:28. That says, and we know that all things work together for good to those that love God, to those who are the called according to His purpose. I can honestly say that I do love God, but I fall short of His commanded will, because I'm supposed to love Him with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, and there's still little parts that don't do it. It's not what I want.
Yeah.
So I don't quite I don't quite measure up. But again, all things work together for good. Another translation say, God causes all things to work together for good. He has taken my mistakes, my shortcomings, my disobedience, my rebellion. He has taken those things and still worked through them to put me, to every once in a while be in the right place at the right time. So that's, I'm beginning to understand his sovereign will
good.
More.
All right, let's turn to Matthew chapter 22, because we have two testimonies that we just heard of Christians saying that I fall short. Of course, that's really the testimony of every believer, right?
Every human being.
Yeah, well, it should be anyways. I've been studying church history, and there are two pretty significant figures of recent church history. Recent is in the last few hundred years. Charles Wesley or John Wesley. I think they're both on the same page. But John Wesley, who is the founder of the Methodists, and then a man named Charles Finney, who sort of created the revivalist crusade, influenced Billy Graham. So Charles Finney and John Wesley both believed in sinless perfection. They believed that Christians could reach a state and should reach a state where you literally never sin anymore. And, you know, how many people teach that today? It just seems so foreign to us. I don't know any reliable teachers who continue to teach that. But let's look at Matthew 22. A lot of people think this verse here where Jesus talks about love the Lord your God, you know, the great commandment, the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. A lot of people think that's the gospel. Well, that's not the gospel. Notice what it says, Matthew 22, starting in verse 34. But when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. Then one of them, a lawyer, asked Jesus a question, testing him and saying, Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? So is Jesus about to talk about the law or the gospel? He's talking about the law. This is not the gospel, but he says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, which every single one of us, every single human being falls short of this. Nobody keeps the first commandment. Some keep it better than others, but nobody keeps the first commandment of the law, right? All have sinned and have come short of the glory of God. And the second commandment is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. How many people truly love their neighbor, love others as much as they love themselves? See, this condemns us. This is not the gospel. This really, if we take an honest look, this condemns us because we're not, as you guys said, we're not living up. And because we do not live up, that's why we need the gospel. So that's kind of what the Sermon on the Mount is really about. But let's continue on, because I've heard over the past couple years pastors talk about the gospel, and then they start talking about the first great commandment and the second, love your neighbor. I'm like, that's the law. That's not the gospel. You don't want Jesus judging you by that. Okay. B, the nature of God's will. Does everyone agree with that? You knew that, right? Now, once we believe the gospel, God gives us a new heart. We want to obey, and then we do love our neighbor. We do love God. But as long as we're alive in this flesh, the flesh is sinful. As long as we're here on earth living in this sinful flesh, we're never going to get to that sinless perfection state. And maybe I shouldn't say this, but you know, John Wesley and Charles Finney, to even teach that, I believe it's false doctrine, so to even teach that showed you that they weren't sinlessly perfect. Otherwise, they wouldn't be teaching it. Marcus.
Yeah, you should not use that word as one word, but use it as two, the word sinless. You should just sin less. And as at my age, and as I hopefully am being sanctified, and hopefully and prayerfully am becoming more like Christ, I recognize that I am further and further away from sinless than I ever used to think that I was.
Yeah.
I'm further away from being like Christ than I was, even though it has been my lifetime prayer ever since a small child to be like Jesus. That was my bedtime prayer. Be a better boy like Jesus, in whose name I pray, was the way I prayed all my life.
Yeah, the more you grow, the more you realize those other little things that you weren't even aware of them before, but now they seem bigger the more you grow. And I don't mean to criticize John Wesley. He was a committed preacher of the gospel, but I just think that one thing is wrong, and it seemed to fit in here. B, the nature of God's will. God's sovereign will and commanded will are better understood in light of their respective characteristics. Okay, so we're going to read from the column of the sovereign will of God. Number one, it's secret, known only to God, except as revealed through history or revelation. Two, cannot be resisted or thwarted. Okay, so can the commanded will of God be resisted? Yeah, it's resisted every day. But the sovereign will of God cannot be resisted or thwarted. Three, it encompasses both good and evil. So God takes all things, including evil, and he works it out for the good. Four, it's comprehensive, controls all aspects of life, time, and history. And then number five, the believer is not commanded to know or discover what God has not revealed. There are the secret things of God that we just don't know. So there's things that God is planning to do in the world, and I believe the book of Revelation in particular lays out what God is planning to do in the future, but there's still some things that we just don't know. And the reason we don't know is because God has not revealed it to us. So that's the sovereign will of God. Any questions, comments on this?
Mark LeClaire had one.
Okay.
Joyce had her hand up.
Oh, no. We moved on.
Okay. All right. Sorry.
Hold on.
Okay. The commanded will. The commanded will. I don't mind going backwards, Joyce. That's okay.
That's fine.
All right.
I have forgot it already. Anyway.
All right. Yeah. Okay, the commanded will. It's revealed in the Bible. So if you want to know what the will of God is, that would be my first advice. Hey, read the Bible. There's all these people, what's the will of God for my life? Are you reading the Bible?
Sanctification.
Yeah, because if you're not reading the scripture, stop asking if you're not reading scripture. So look to the word of God and then, pray about it and see what happens. But God's commanded will is revealed in the Bible. Number two, it can be resisted or disobeyed. Right? Thou shalt not covet. And then you see something your neighbor brought home and you're like, oh man, I really like that. Well, there you go. You just disobeyed the commanded will of God. Okay. Three, involves only that which is good and holy. That's the commanded will. So the Ten Commandments. This is what God has revealed. It's right, it's good, it's just, it's holy, and we know it. And then number four, it's specific and provides principles for living. And then number five, the commanded will of God, believers are exhorted to know, understand, and obey all that God has revealed. Okay, so I think we see the difference between God's sovereign will and commanded will. Does anyone not see the difference or want clarification? Okay.
It is sometimes difficult. We'll find out.
Yeah, well, it gets a little more challenging when you read a verse, and this is what we're going to do now. We're going to read a verse, and you're going to say, okay, that's commanded will, or that's sovereign will. So this will get a little challenging. But Larry, you had your hand up.
Yeah, I think it was in the sermon that John MacArthur did for the beginning here, where he said that if you're unwilling to obey what you can read in Scripture, God is not going to reveal anything more.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you have to, the light that you're given, you have to be obedient to that light. Otherwise, you're not going to get any more.
Right. Yeah, you need to be faithful in the little things before God is going to entrust bigger things. Okay, you ready to be examined? Which is which? The sovereign will or the commanded will? Well, even if you're not ready, too bad, we're doing it right now. Philippians 2:13. It is God who is at work in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. I'll read it one more time. It is God who is at work in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. This is what? The sovereign will or commanded will? Who says sovereign will? Okay, who says commanded will? Somebody had commanded will, I bet. Well, I have the teacher's guide, so it makes it easy for me. So, but this is the sovereign will of God. Does anyone want to maybe explain why? Why do you think this is the sovereign will?
Because it says this is God's will.
Okay, it is God who is at work in you both to will.
Because he's at work in us, but we're still not up to the 100%. We're not getting A pluses.
Yeah.
I'm glad that he's at work in us. But again, and I know I could tell from the beginning that you don't want to talk much about free will or not.
Well, if you bring it up, yeah.
Well, our will, I mean, is Philippians 1:6 in here too?
I just didn't want to derail the conversation right from the start. That was the main thing.
Philippians 1:6 is number 5 down in there, but it's talking about our wills are very strong things.
Right. Yeah. So man has a will. We've talked about this before. I would argue man's will really isn't free because Romans says that the natural man is a slave to sin. And even when we're regenerate and have the Holy Spirit within us, we still have to contend and mortify the sinful flesh. So I think in heaven we will be free. I don't like the term free will only because we're not truly free. It makes it sound like man is morally neutral and we can kind of go either way, but we definitely have a bent towards sin. So that's why I don't care for the term free will, but without a question, mankind has a will. And because we have a will, God's will gets resisted because we want to do what we want to do. That's the thing with free will. Yeah, we have it, but we use it to disobey God's will. That's the problem, Stacy.
Actually, I think you just said it, but I was going to say, even though we have a bent toward the sinful flesh in us, we still have the free will to obey that or to resist that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this was another thing that came up briefly in our church history series. There was a man named Pelagius. I think he was a priest in the, 4th, 5th century. And he said that mankind has the ability within himself to do good, to will for himself, to choose God. And he said man could do that without God's grace. Like we have it within ourselves. Because God says, be holy, for I am holy. So we must have the ability to be holy. And we have it within ourselves. We don't need the grace of God. That was considered a heresy by the early church. And Augustine fought against Pelagius and all the rest. But we do have the ability to choose God. But that's only in response to the grace of God. So we hear the gospel. We receive some measure of grace. And we can respond to that. But we would never choose it for ourselves without God moving first. Yeah.
So how would you explain, because I do know people who are of this frame of mind, is maybe they don't have Christ in their life, but they'll say, well, I'm a good person. I do these good things.
Yeah.
It's not for God that they're doing it, but to edify
right.
their own thought of what good is.
Right. Well, I think God, well, he's the creator, and he has built, it's built into the creation that if you do good, good things will happen. Like, someone could sort of outwardly, to a degree, obey the Ten Commandments, or at least the second half, and things are going to go better for you if you're not lying to everybody, and you're not stealing, and you're not murdering people. You're going to have a better life if you obey these commandments. So I think people see the goodness in that, even if they don't do it for Christ's sake. And then I think God can be working in people's heart without them even realizing it. Larry.
I was thinking about man's will, but Jeremiah 17:9, just as we're talking, you have that bent towards sinfulness. The heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. Who can know it? So there, you know, whatever we have going on inside of us, that the two natures as believers, you know, there's still that fight, you know, where we can be deceived or deceive ourselves.
Right.
Because of our heart, our lusts, that's where fights and wars come from.
Right.
As James says.
Yeah, and we need to be realistic about this, that, yeah, all sin comes short of the glory of God. But we don't want to just keep staying on that again and again, because there are people, the more you obey and you get into the habit of doing the right thing, it becomes easier to do the right thing. And there are a lot of people, yeah, they're not perfect, but you look at their life and their works and their commitment to the Lord. And, you know, there are people in the Old Testament in particular where it said that they were a just man. Like, you look at them, you really can't see anything on the surface. You can't see anything in their life that would say, hey, whoa, look at that. So you can live an obedient life. We don't want to make it seem like, well, it's impossible, so what's the use? You know, we don't want to make it sound like that. Okay, back to this. The sovereign will, commanded will. 1 Thessalonians 4:3. For this is the will of God, your sanctification. That is, you shall abstain from sexual immorality. Is that the sovereign will of God or the commanded will of God?
Commanded.
Yeah, that's the commanded will. It's like it's pretty clear what God is saying, and you're supposed to know it because he's telling you. Okay. So the first one was the sovereign will. You don't really know how God is working in you or what he's going to do, but this we do know. So if somebody does say, hey, what's the will of God for my life? Just tell them 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 3. That might not be what they're looking for, but that is true. Okay, number three, 2 Corinthians 6:14. Do not be bound together with unbelievers. Or as we are accustomed to saying with the King James and New King James, do not be what? Unequally yoked together with unbelievers. So is this the sovereign will of God or the commanded will of God?
Commanded.
Yeah, I mean, this is a very clear command. Now, is it resisted? Is it broken? Yes. And God, can God still use that? I mean, I think there are Christians who have married non-Christians, and then later on, the non-believer got saved because they were married to the Christian. So that wasn't God's will at first, but he used it for good. But this is clearly the commanded will of God. Okay, Matthew 7:21, he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. He who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Well, that's definitely commanded will, right? Because how would you even know? All right, Philippians 1:6, Marcus mentioned this. He who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Jesus Christ. So which is this? Sovereign will or commanded will?
Sovereign.
Sovereign will. Okay, why? Why is it the sovereign will? Okay, he. This is what God is doing. So he who began a good work in you will perfect it. You know, you think of the parable of the sower, right? The seeds kind of gets thrown out. Some seeds fall on good ground and the stony ground and everything else. The way I look at it, that there are seeds being planted, right? And it might take a while for that seed to germinate and pop up. In order for it to pop up, it has to be watered. But once it's there, you know, God is going to grow it into a tree, a bush. He's going to bring it to completion. But there's some seed that gets tossed out and it just never grows, never takes root. But the promise is that once it takes and once it starts to grow up, God is going to complete that work. And we never know. There's a lot of people, a lot of seeds were planted in their life, so to speak. People are watering in their life. What's going to happen to that person? I don't know. It hasn't happened yet. We don't really know. But for the person who knows Christ, God will complete that work. But then there are other people that it looks like there's something there. And then, you know, 10 years, 20 years later, you realize, no, that wasn't the case. So we don't really know how it's going to work out. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. This one's pretty easy. I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Sovereign will or commanded will?
Sovereign will.
Sovereign will. Of course, then I think about it, that verse doesn't even tell them what those plans are. To have a plan for good and not evil. But anyways, in the book it says sovereign will, so we'll stick with that. Yes, Mark?
Where does that leave the unbeliever in this?
It leaves the unbeliever in the dark. Of course, I guess we're all in the dark to some degree with God's sovereign will. But the unbeliever has the commanded will of God, and they are not only are they not following it, they don't really have any desire to, at least not for the right reason. I don't know if that answers your question. So here's the thing. If you take the Ten Commandments, if you take what is revealed in the Word of God and you bring it to a believer, now maybe they weren't doing what they should, but a believer will respond to the Word, right? If you bring what the Word of God says, what God has revealed to an unbeliever, they're like, why are you wasting my time? Right? So there's a totally different response of how the believer responds to the Word of God versus the unbeliever. And I think that says it all. Now, when a believer responds to the Word of God the same way the unbeliever does, then you have a problem, right? And you got to take that to the next step and all the rest. But I think one of the things that confuses us today is there are so many false converts in the world that you see Christians and non-Christians kind of acting the same way. And you're like, what's going on? But that's because there's so many false converts. Any remarks on that before we move on? Yes, Marcus.
Becoming clearer to me because his sovereign will are all the things that he is doing, and his commanded will are all the things that we're supposed to do.
Yep, good.
And again, the contrast being his faithfulness versus our unfaithfulness. We fail all the time at his commanded will. He never fails at what he's supposed to do.
Yep.
He always does it.
Yep. Amen. Very simply put, but very clear and eloquently put. Thank you. All right. Anything before we move on? Okay. C, the response to God's will. How are we doing, Carlos? We've got another page. We'll get one more lesson in this, for sure. C, response to God's will. How should we respond to God's sovereign will? Proverbs 3, 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he will make your paths straight. So that's how we should respond to the sovereign will of God. Also 1 Peter 4:19, therefore those also who suffer according to the will of God shall entrust their souls to a faithful Creator in doing what is right. Okay, so he talks about those who suffer according to the will of God. Have you ever had something happen and you're like, why, God? Why did you allow this? Why are you bringing this into my life? Why are you causing it? You might ask that. I started on Wednesday a Bible study on the radio on the book of Ruth. And Naomi, remember, her husband and her two sons died. And she said, God's hand is heavy against me. God, she basically comes out and says, God is against me. You know, call me Mara, which means bitter, because she felt that God, she didn't come right out and put it this way, but she like, God did this to me. God is against me. That seems to be how she felt, which, you know, it's understandable to feel that way. So did God actually do that to punish her or anything like, yeah, who knows? I mean, it's in his sovereign will, I guess, but not necessarily. But sometimes we will see something that happens, something happens to us, and we wonder, God, why? And then you remember that God conforms his people to the image of Christ through what? Suffering.
Suffering.
You know, the times where you're going through hardship and pain, and those are the times where God is pruning you, as some people say, or those are the times where God is really conforming us. And it's not necessarily a punishment. That's the thing. When something bad happens, sometimes it's pretty obvious. If I smoke cigarettes for 40 years and I get lung cancer, I don't know, it's pretty obvious it was my fault. But, you know, sometimes when bad things happen, it's not necessarily God punishing you. It's God allowing it to grow you and shape and mold you into the image of Christ. But we don't really know all the times. So it's a mystery, Marcus.
Well, we sometimes think that Job's story is, you know, singular or extreme, but I believe that the principle applies. And again, we don't necessarily like the fact, but I think that God sometimes brags about us. He likes to prove to the devil that we really love him, and this is why, you know, our faith is what pleases him. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. So this is how we please him. We trust him even through suffering, even through unfairness, even through unjust accusations and persecutions and things that we don't deserve. But in the large scheme of things, there's so many things. You know, God wouldn't really deserve to have to lose his son or to give his son, and Jesus didn't deserve to be crucified and to bear all our sins. So
yeah,
life is so short compared to eternity that all the suffering, because of course, like, you know, my friend Giles suffers a lot, and we just keep memorizing all these verses about suffering, and boy, there's going to be no one happier than Giles, you know, in the rapture when this suffering is over.
Sure. And one last point, and then we'll close. You think of something that happened early on in the church. There was great persecution. Remember the persecution that arose after Stephen was martyred. What did that do? What did that persecution do? Persecution would have been perceived as bad, but it caused the believers to flee from Jerusalem and to spread out, and that brought the gospel to the areas around them. So God worked it out according to his will. All right, thank you. We'll pick up next time.